Hey, this is Calvin Parker. You're listening to the Unbelievers Podcast.
There were several groups. One of the principal ones was the reptilians from the Iran complex.
Without any exaggeration, it was like being on fire inside.
Rats were eating you up inside.
This stuff was in my mouth. It felt like it was 500 degrees. It was unbelievably hot.
My first question would be, were you a member of the Church of Satan, a card-carrying member of the Church of Satan?
I don't understand.
There's always an argument for no reason. You know, just because somebody can fake something doesn't necessarily.
We found a life form, and that's when I started shitting my pants.
So for the person who called up, I am carrying an alien.
An alien baby, and we covered right here, okay?
Okay.
Something is happening. What is it? That's the question. So do UFOs exist? It depends on what you mean, exist.
In the 1980s and 90s, there are many now prominent names that came to the attention of the public to demand the truth about UFO disclosure and extraterrestrials. Linda Moulton Howe and the Mutilated Cows, Phil Schneider and the Dolce Wars, Bob Lazar. Now, adding to the super team of truthers is a man who has not only seen extraterrestrial UFOs, he can communicate directly with them. Tonight, the Unbelievers Podcast closes the book on our UFO trilogy by discussing one of the most interesting individuals in the world of ufology, a man who is fighting against the global elites and their former pop-punk frontmen in order to free humanity from fear and change the future of human history through meditation. So join us now for Dr. Stephen Greer and Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind. Right here in the program, we continue to learn to unlearn everything you know. Hello and welcome to the Unbelievers Podcast. I'm your host, Rus Ryan. And joining me as always is my co-host, Drea Mora. Hello, Drea.
Hey, what's up?
And our soundboard engineer and producer, Rob Okey.
This guy was huge.
What's going on, guys? How you doing?
What's up?
Yeah, I don't know if Rob's talking about himself or tonight's topic. The person that we're getting into tonight, some would say he is pretty huge.
Yeah. Well, he's huge in the UFO scene, I guess you could say.
He's kind of also like huge physically. Like,
yeah, he used to be buff.
He's buff. He's got to hide it, man. He can't just show it to everybody. You got to join his OnlyFans to see the rest of that.
I'm good.
But again, yeah, we cannot get our hands off these UFO guys. And yeah, this is a little trilogy. I know we've been kind of going a lot off with these guys, but hey, it's hard to stop. So let's just get into it now. It's time for another UFO special. It's Stephen Greer and Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind.
What am I going to do when the aliens get here? Austin is powered up enough to fill that landscape. 2.7 in the cockpit. Chemicals ride through Saturn and cross. From the Mercury astronaut, George Austin. From the economics liberation in Boston. Massachusetts protected by the Army and Red Berets.
Yeah. Well, cool Keith with aliens. Tonight, nice. We'll be discussing another very prominent individual in the UFO field, the one Stephen Greer, Dr. Stephen Greer.
How dare you? It's Dr. Stephen Greer.
Put some respect on that name when you say it. It's Dr. Stephen Greer. Okay?
I won't slip again. Dr. Stephen Greer.
Yeah, oil it up, man, just like he does.
Yes. So we can get into him, much like, you know, we've already covered Bob Lazar, Chuck Zukowski, and the 37th. The list goes on, the others, all the great UFO names. So let's get into this guy. Dr. Stephen M. Greer has been a well-known figure in ufology for decades and has an interesting body of work to show for it. And here's some of the backstory on Dr. Greer. He was born in Charlotte, North Carolina in 1955, and at age 8, he had an encounter with a UFO at close range. This event would inspire his lifelong interest in UFOs. But before we get to that, here's a little bit of his education. Greer was trained as a transcendental meditation teacher and served as director of a meditation organization. He received degrees in biology from Appalachian State and an MD from East Tennessee State University, and in 1989 received his Virginia medical license, becoming an emergency room physician. And that's his doctor origin.
Wow,
Dr. Greer,
yeah.
Emergency room hero, TM teacher. That's exciting, yes?
Yeah, exciting, yes. That's a lot to be proud of, honestly.
It's interesting because he balances both sides of the scale. You know what I mean? He's got the transcendental meditation thing going on, but also like just a straight up ER doctor, which is, it's cool. Like it's really, there's a dichotomy there between those two things. I think that's very interesting.
He cares for the mind and the spirit, or the body and the spirit. Like that is kind of rare.
He's usually a man of faith and a man of science, which is very
science
rare.
Rarely,
you know,
goes,
I mean,
over that. Yeah, true.
But he saw a UFO. He's a UFO guy. That's going to be
a UFO guy also, which is, this is why I like this guy.
He runs the whole gamut.
He would enter into UFO research world in 1990 when he founded the Center for the Study of Extraterrestrial Intelligence, or CSETI. Now remember, SETI already existed since like 1984. This is CSETI though, guys. This is his thing. It's different.
Okay. What's the C stand for in CSETI?
Center. It's just the center for it.
Oh, okay. All right.
Okay.
I guess,
Center SETI. Okay.
Do you?
CSETI has a mission, though. The mission is to create a diplomatic and research-based initiative to contact extraterrestrial civilizations.
Cool.
The official statements regarding its intentions also include a new category of extraterrestrial encounters, namely CE5, or Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind. This was defined by Greer as human-initiated contact and or communication with extraterrestrial life. That's what the big thing, that's what sets them apart. They're very much about CE5.
Mm. Yeah, they're making the first move here.
I like CE5. I'm going to go right out there and say it.
It sounds cooler that way. Well, I don't know. I don't know. Close Encounters, maybe it's too evocative of the movie. And they're like, nah, CE5. It's a little cooler.
I love the movie. I'm a big fan of the movie. I have the soundtrack on vinyl. I have it framed. And
oh, wow.
Like, it's
oh,
like,
you don't
it's,
listen to it.
Oh, it's special. You know what I mean?
That's old stuff, man. That's the third kind. The fifth kind is a much different thing.
I know. It's different. This is like the sequel, like on a whole different level. It's like the documentary sequel.
It's beefed up a little.
Yeah, it's plus two. It's two levels better.
Yeah, they skipped the other one.
So after founding CSETI, his big splash in the UFO verse comes in 1993 when he founded something called the Disclosure Project. This is a research project, and their goal is to disclose to the public the government's alleged knowledge of UFOs, extraterrestrials, advanced energy, and propulsion systems. The Disclosure Project was founded in an effort to grant amnesty to government whistleblowers willing to violate their security oaths by sharing insider knowledge about UFOs. So he created this to save Bob Lazar types. Greer wanted to protect our good whistleblowers.
Mm. Yeah, good. I think it's a really noble thing to do.
Yeah,
it is. It seemed like the most logical way to, if this stuff is true, to be able to get it out, to be able to protect the few people that can come forward.
Yeah.
Yeah. They should be protected. I mean, yeah, 100%.
Greer's got men all over Bob Lazar's place. We're taking care of all whistleblowers.
Well, but, I mean, Bob Lazar's getting himself into his own shit with his, you know, his pimping. And pimping ain't easy, so you know what I mean? That this guy's never done. He doesn't have. This is the one thing you can say about Dr. Greer. There's no, like, weird, like. Like, he wasn't a pimp just randomly at any point in the story.
No, just
not
you
that
know,
we know of.
Not that
he's got his own weirdness.
Not that we know of, really, I guess, yeah. As far as we know.
As far as we know. So he starts this Disclosure Project, and since that time, he starts becoming very well-known. He's a frequent guest on Coast to Coast AM with good old Art Bell since the beginning. Since Coast to Coast started, Greer was on there. He was also featured on the 1994 Larry King UFO special titled The UFO Cover-Up? Question mark? I have a question. Have you guys ever heard of this 2-hour Larry King UFO special?
No, never.
When did this come out?
This came out in 1994, and I'm going to give you the TV guide description fucking, here.
I was a little kid. I definitely don't remember this.
Yeah, I think I was in kindergarten. I don't know.
Yeah, so according to TV guide, I'll catch you guys up. Larry King brings his talk show to the desert outside Area 51 for a live broadcast. In a combination of live panel interviews and pre-recorded inserts, the show explores the evidence for UFOs and the alleged government cover-up of UFO information. So, do you guys want to hear Dr. Greer talking to Larry King in the desert, maybe?
Greer.
Hell yeah,
yes,
old school Greer.
Absolutely.
Hell yeah.
In the desert, yes.
With Larry King?
Well, we heard some of these are inserts and some of these are actual live in the desert. What do you think Greer's going to be?
Not live in the desert. He's not from the desert, is he? He's not.
Michael Dukakis, George Bush, Mikhail Gorbachev.
I don't know, man. I don't know. I hope he's there with them. I hope they're together.
All right, so let's find out. Here is the intro to the UFO cover-up.
We are back in Rachel, Nevada, with our first two distinguished guests. Stephen Greer is a North Carolina doctor. He does a lot more than watch the skies. He fires off messages, and he says that someone or something is responding. Dr. Greer is looking for close encounters of the fifth kind. Also here, the dean of UFO researchers, a man who says the world governments have engineered a kind of cosmic Watergate to hide the truth from the public, the esteemed nuclear physicist Stanton Friedman. What is key, Stephen, about this area, Area 51?
Well, this area has been reported for a number of years to house black operations from the Air Force and other agencies that have allegedly been back engineering alien spacecraft, as they're called, or extraterrestrial spacecraft.
This is the place where the Air Force supposedly hides things from us.
Yeah, I'm not saying that that's the case, but that's what is reported here.
What do you think goes on here, Doctor?
Mister, please, Larry, no okay. Free degrees.
Okay, you're a doctor, you're a mister.
Yeah, there's no question that there's all kinds of secret government development projects going on over the hill. Whether any of them have anything to do with flying saucers is another question entirely.
I'm sorry. Okay, that's not the greatest audio, but there you have it. It's Larry King, Stephen Greer, and Stan Friedman chilling in the desert with some
amazing
real talk about UFOs.
That's insane. I'm so glad this happened. I'm surprised, again, I feel like lately this whole month has just been things that I should have known about but don't. So this is good. But...
Dude, what I would pay to be a fly on a cactus in that desert with the three of those guys hanging out, man. What else do you think they talked about when they weren't recording? I can only
imagine.
Oh, man, my
but
God.
We got some good stuff to remember it by. Because Larry King is already a soundboard legend, but play soundboard one. We can add this.
What do you think goes on here, Doctor?
Mister, please, Larry, no okay. Free degrees.
I thought that was great. It's nice that he actually was like, no, I'm not that great.
Yeah,
I know. play soundboard two. I know it's kind of a throwaway, but I don't know. His reply kind of sounds like a vaudeville act.
Okay, you're a doctor, you're a mister.
Yeah,
all right, you're a doctor, you're a mister. What do you got about the UFOs, guys?
All right, you're a doctor, you're a mister. Whatever the fuck.
He doesn't care. He's like, yeah, whatever. Let's talk about this thing I don't believe in.
Yeah. But you heard it. So since they are broadcasting from somewhere near Area 51, they talk about the secret bases there, and they talk about the famous warning sign outside of the base. We've all seen that warning sign. Head back now.
Yeah.
So Larry King asked Dr. Greer about that sign.
What does the sign at the gate say, Stephen?
I haven't actually been
What's
over there.
What's the name of this base?
There are several names. Area 51 is the larger name. We're near Nellis Air
That's
Force Base. There's Groom Lake. There's Papoose Lake. There's a whole bunch of different
and
facilities.
And the Air Force
out here
tells us this is what?
Until very recently, they were saying there's nothing out here.
No,
the
that
secret
thing
place
out there is not there.
Yeah, it's not there. You can't look at it, and the guards can't look at your videotape on your camera because they're not cleared to see what isn't there.
We'll get to that later. What, Dr. Greer, do you believe? By the way, your specialty is what?
Emergency medicine, emergency and trauma medicine.
So you're in an emergency room every day?
Yes. Treating... Well, not every day, but enough.
You treat trauma patients?
Yes.
How'd you get into this?
Well, it's a long story. I had an interest. My uncle worked on a project working on a Apollo mission, and I had an interest in space. And many years ago, I had a sighting at fairly close range of an object that was clearly not an airplane. And from that, my interest grew, and I developed an interest to the point that I founded a research organization called CSETI.
Oh, man. This whole thing, Larry King is so shot out of a cannon because he loves UFOs so much. He doesn't have time for any, like, long-winded nonsense. And in the beginning, man, Stan Friedman, he had to go bail Greer out from that grilling. He was, like, putting a blanket over him. He's like, what's on the sign? What's the base called? He's like, Stan has to jump in. Like, no, it's okay.
It's such an interesting, like, dynamic here. It's really weird. I never thought I'd hear this, but at least... At least he did better than I would have. Like, if I had heard him say, like, so how'd you get into this? I would have gone into how I got into ER medicine and trauma. Like,
it's a two-hour special,
you
too.
You meant UFOs.
It's 2 hours. I've got plenty of time.
When you say that they're in the desert, like, are they in, like, one of those Winnebago, mobile studios in the
I
middle
wish.
Of the desert? Or are they, like, on a table, like, in
it's
the sand?
It's a desk sitting in the sand, yes. And they, I guess they have the film crew behind them and their truck and all that. But it just looks
some
like they're sitting
chairs
in the middle of nowhere.
Well,
one
I guess
sitting on a cooler
at that point, though, like if Larry's that committed If he's that committed, you know what I mean? He's really got to just go all in at that point. If he's already in the desert with these guys, he can't go there and act like he doesn't, like he's like it's bullshit and just like, why did they drag me out here? Like, you know what I mean?
Shorten it. I hate being in the desert.
He's kind of got to go along here. With it. So I think.
Well, he is. He's a big proponent
of UFOs.
That's
what I mean.
Like, he's always defending it. So I think this is him going all in. And I love how he just goes after him. Place it on board three. Poor Greer.
Well, it's a long story. I had an interest. My uncle.
Shorten it.
So short himself.
You know what's funny? I'm going to Colorado next week, and I actually today just looked up. I was like, I wonder how far it is from Denver to Area 51, because I know, you know, they border each other there, New Mexico and Colorado. So I was like, I wonder, but it's like 7 hours, so I don't know if I can make it happen on this trip,
dude.
But I do one day want to see that sign they were talking about. You know what I mean? I want to go there and get like a selfie with it.
One of these days, man, we're gonna do the we'll do Las Vegas and hit up Zach's Haunted Museum, and then we'll just head out there. Like, why not?
That's really happening. Like, next year, that's gonna happen.
Absolutely. Rob's worried about running into the ghost of Larry King now, and he's gonna ask him about that sign, and he's gonna be like, I don't know, ask Stan Freeman's ghost.
Yeah, I'll be like,
well, it's a long story. I had an interest. My uncle.
Shorten it.
That's a great clip. But Dr. Greer would recover from all that, and he would give a very succinct answer to this next question from the king.
At this minute, do you believe?
Well, you know, I separate my belief from what I know. Okay.
What do you know?
Okay, our assessment at this point is that there is at least one extraterrestrial civilization which has managed to make its way to our corner of the universe. And number two, that there's no evidence at all that they have hostile intentions towards this planet. And number three, that the priority at this point must be trying to establish some sort of a liaison to them, some sort of a diplomatic liaison to them. And that's what we're working on.
Okay, so according to Greer, there's one civilization, they're not hostile, and they really need a friend to talk to them.
Mm-hmm. Classic, like, we come in peace, like, take me to your leader sort of thing. But like your spiritual leader.
It's just interesting that they would need friends. Like, I don't know, how boring are the other aliens that they're
there's just one civilization, he says.
So but I mean, like, okay, like, granted, we're always trying to reach out, or at least some of us are, because it's an interesting, fascinating topic. But, you know, I'd go so far as to say the majority of humans are fine with just dealing with other humans. You know,
yeah, that's hard enough at this point,
it
right?
It is difficult, you know? Enough to wrap your mind around the human race. So, yeah, like, we need to first get a good bearing on that before we can start talking to the other.
Yeah, there's just too much. Maybe we are that complex and annoying. I don't know.
Well, Greer got past it. He can worry about this, and he sounded fairly confident in that answer. So, Larry King wants to know, how can he be so sure about all this?
How do you know this?
Well, I personally have been within a few hundred feet of these craft as they have been maneuvering.
You've seen them?
We have seen them. I've been on research teams that we have put out in areas where these objects have been seen, and we have been able to signal to them. We have been able to vector them within a few hundred feet of our location, 10 feet above the ground. There's no question in my mind that these are real and not a figment of anyone's imagination.
Stanton, do you believe Dr. Greer?
Oh, a cliffhanger. But you hear that. He is signaling them. He is vectoring them, mm-hmm. 10 feet off the ground. He sounds like he's starting to apply for that liaison job, right?
Yeah. I mean, it sounds like he knows what he's doing. Like you said, he sounds really confident. I'd be a lot more scared, personally.
He sounds qualified for the job, at least. Or it sounds like, or Christo Rapolo would be another great representative,
oh,
I think.
Oh, man.
Because he's
thinking
also
of him the whole time. Yeah.
When you make up what the job that's needed is, you go, oh, look at that. I'm the perfect candidate for this job
expert.
I've vetted.
Hey, come on. There should be.
That only I know about.
That is
Why
a position
not?
That should exist. I think he's right on this. I think this is a great idea. There should be, like, it's weird if a whole group of people go up to, like, say what's up to some aliens. You should have one person who you're like, all right, who's going to talk to him? And that's
Let's get my own
guy.
Alien then. I'll get a better one.
Do it then. Because that's the whole thing. It's got to be on a volunteer type basis. Someone who wants to put themselves out there and risk getting, you know, crispy crittered if they want to fry him instead of talk to him.
It's a weird job, but somebody's got to do it.
Yeah.
You know what I
yes.
mean?
Greer put himself out there, and Larry King just asked Stan Friedman what he thinks about this. What do you think Stan Friedman's going to say? The dean of UFOs.
Oh, boy. I don't know.
All right, let's find out. RIP Stan Friedman.
There's such different types of UFO people,
yeah,
I guess.
I'm
let's
prepared
see.
To hear some kind of naysaying, but let's see.
Yes, I believe Dr. Greer. My own beliefs are a little different in the sense that I agree with what he said, but I carry it a lot farther. I'm convinced after 36 years of study and investigation that the evidence is overwhelming that planet Earth is being visited by extraterrestrial spacecraft. That means some UFOs are alien spacecraft. Most are not. I don't care about those.
Right.
Second, we're dealing with a kind of cosmic Watergate. That means some few people in the government know what's going on, not everybody. Third, none of the arguments made by the debunkers like Carl Sagan and Phil Klass, who never refer to the relevant evidence, stand up under careful scrutiny. And fourth, we're dealing with the biggest story of the millennium. Visits to planet Earth, successful cover-up of the best data, the bodies and the wreckage from 1947 for 47 years.
Why?
I don't speak for the government, but I'll give you five reasons.
Oh, break it up, you two.
Damn.
It gets heated in the desert. And Sam Friedman gives a, do you believe him? He's like, yes, well, but actually, no. He's like, you know, Greer believes three things. He's like, yeah, right, I can list things all night. I'm Sam Friedman. I got five, six other things, I believe.
This whole confrontation keeps, like, riding the line of being, like, an argument and being friendly. Like, I can't figure out what this interview is supposed to be exactly.
It's a slightly more friendly version of Unbeliever Skeptic, even though they're both believers, or all of them are, but it's still like this kind of really tongue-in-cheek, like, my way's better than yours. It's really weird. I don't like the tension.
They have to sit very close to each other. But I think Greer and Stanton probably get along, even though, I mean, that's what set Stanton Friedman apart. He believes all kinds of stuff. He doesn't have this, like, one dogma, or at least he didn't. And that's why he got so many TV gigs. He was open to every case.
But he's like a nuts and bolts guy. You know what I mean? He thinks that there's physical objects that are made out of metal, and he has really done
it. He's like old steampunk man. No, he's not.
isn't he like old school, like, flying saucer guy? Isn't he, Stan Friedman?
Sure, I guess so. But he believes in all kinds of different aliens.
He's like kind of
too.
Less spiritual and more.
That's what I mean. Like, he's more on like a physical UFO thing, and Greer is way more like a metaphysical UFO, spiritual UFO thing.
Yeah, he wants to connect and understand the beings themselves. He wants to know about the people who were in the crafts, and Stanton Friedman wants to know more about the crafts themselves, which I think they should make a good team. You know?
I think they're into the same shit, but it's just they have different, they're looking at it from two different perspectives.
For
and,
sure.
And making up their own mind about what
but
it
you know
is
what?
That they're experiencing.
That's how the best science is made.
I think if Greer was on there, Stanton Friedman was probably championing him a little bit at this point to get him on there. Because
I don't know their relationship.
Of course, always on TV. I'm not too familiar either, but Stanton loves to list things. He lists a bunch more things he knows more than Greer. And then Larry goes back to Dr. Greer about the alleged contact he's having with these extraterrestrial UFOs.
You've contacted them, or you believe you've contacted them.
We have had limited exchange.
Yes. By what means?
By light signaling and by graphic signaling. And
what do you mean light signaling?
Like basically, for example, if an object is arriving out in the field, we will try to engage
it. By the way, I hope it happens now.
Well, who knows? But we will signal to it, and then it will signal back congruently.
Like saying what? You'll beep what?
It's not to say anything. It is simply to establish that they see us and we see them.
Three flashes back. That idea, Larry.
I see. No, it's four flashes. We're here, you're here, we're there, you're there.
Okay. Yes, exactly like that, Larry King.
Well, he'd be the worst person to talk to the aliens, honestly. He's like, what are you doing here? What do you want? Like, make it quick. Make it snappy. I'm busy.
Hearing it explained like that, too, is not as impressive as saying, I was vectoring with my light summoning. And he's like, it's like you blink at him. He's like, one, two, three, boom, you're there, I'm there, we're there. I think there's a soundboard clip for that. There has to be, right?
But we're here, you're here, we're there, you're there.
Yes, exactly, Larry. Thank you. So it goes. But like I said, way less impressive. The way when Larry really makes it break down what he's talking about, it's just like, so you're blinking like a little laser light and they're blinking back. What is
he
that?
He makes it awkward for the alien because he's like, I'm here, you're there, you're here, I'm there, you're there. They're like, wait, where do we go?
Yes,
what are we doing?
We are. Now
like,
what?
Like, relax.
He really
okay?
just knocks it in the dirt and just kind of was like, he believes in the stuff, but he makes it sound like he's so unimpressed by all of this. Like, okay, big deal.
Yeah, he didn't take a moment to like really react to it. And be like, wait a second. So you're telling me that you are pointing something at the, you know what I mean? He didn't actually he was just kind of like, oh yeah, so you know that they're there, and then you show them the thing, and then you go, hey, I'm here and you're there, and yeah, whatever.
They're in the desert. He could do it right there. He could literally do what he's talking about.
I think his negative energy is going to weigh everything down. They're not going to be successful with it. You know, they have to.
But Larry King comes up as a pure heart. Larry King really does want to see an alien. Of course he does. He wants to live forever with his lizard people.
Well, part of it, I think, is getting to like a certain place in your mind.
And a certain mindset, yes.
And a certain mindset, and to get into like a certain vibe. And to really feel it. And I think it's tough to do that when you got Larry over there hunched over, fucking staring at you and hitting you with these fucking harsh questions every 2 seconds.
Yeah. With his little, like, his little alien head suspenders that he's wearing. And
Stan Friedman over there, too, just staring at you.
He does have a weird stare, too. I love Stan Friedman. But if he was staring you down with that look of disapproval, I would be pretty uncomfortable. But that's pretty much it for this very early TV appearance. They had tons of other things to get to. We might one day down the road have to just cover this whole thing.
For sure.
But I do have one more Larry King clip, though. Here he is ending the Dr. Greer, Mr. Friedman segment and introducing Open Lines.
We're going to take a break and come back. There'll be more guests, and we'll be including your phone calls. Our numbers are 1-800-348-3900. 1-800-348-3900. This is our TNT UFO special, Larry King in the Desert. We'll be right back. By way of correction, we gave you the wrong 800 number. It's 800-448-3900. 800-448-3900. 3900, not 348. And if someone is at 348, we apologize.
I wish I knew who got those calls that night, man. People must have thought the government was like trying to suppress their calls to Larry King.
Oh, yeah,
no, that
kidding.
Was a number.
I hope it was like a sex line operator.
And
it was
just
like
it made bank.
10,000 people just called into this random sex line.
And they end up staying.
They're like Larry King, and she's just
well,
like,
I'm
no.
here.
Talk about Larry King and aliens and a bunch of guys in the desert together. It's like, what?
Oh, that is so funny.
Sounds like a party.
TNT was having UFO specials back in the day, huh? This is cool. Why don't they do that kind of shit anymore?
Do they not?
They don't really. I mean, they don't bring TNT's around anymore.
They'll bring TNT back, and they'll bring one of these shows back for us. It'll happen. But this is just the beginning for Stephen Greer. He would continue with the CSETI and eventually the Disclosure Project. And in 1998, he would quit his job as a physician to work on the mission of UFO disclosure full time. In May 2001, Greer held a press conference at the National Press Club in Washington, D.C. that featured 20 retired Air Force, Federal Aviation Administration, and intelligence officers who all came forward with their credible stories of UFO encounters and their belief that secret forces within the government are covering up the existence of extraterrestrials for over half a century, and that the media and the scientific community has been manipulated to cover this up from the public. They're paying me to say it like this. Which seems to be the conclusion that many of the disclosure people and whistleblowers have also come to. And that, does that sound about right as far as Stephen Greer's disclosure project?
On point.
Yeah, it's a little satanic panicky, like alien edition, kind
of. It's like elite panic. It's elite panicky. It's almost David Icke levels of power structures involved in this, it seems like.
Right. Well, I mean, I guess so. I was seeing it kind of as the other way around, where he was kind of calling what everybody else was doing as a satanic panic.
That's what I'm talking about.
Oh, okay.
That's what I'm talking about. It's like what they're dealing with is like the satanic panic in a way.
Definitely.
Alien.
At least that's what they're trying to say exists. Like that this alien satanic panic or alien panic, whatever you want to call it, this phenomenon exists.
That's the Dr. Greerverse.
Yeah.
That's the Dr. Greerverse. That's what it is. You have to use this fifth kind or, you know, use your meditation to communicate with them. We're going to get into it. Let's talk a little bit about, let's just get past this, what's about to happen. Because later, Dr. Greer would expand on his theory with his 2017 book, Unacknowledged, An Exposé of the World's Greatest Secret. And this book was also the subject of a 2017 very popular documentary called Unacknowledged. And this thing got a lot of attention a few years ago. Dr. Greer was again got into the UFO truth spotlight. Rob, he was even on Joe Rogan's podcast, wasn't he?
He was on Joe Rogan's podcast, actually. And it was a while ago. I remember because I recently re-looked it up just to see what it looked like. And it was one of the very old Joe Rogan sets. It's like episode 300 and something. And it was an interesting interview. It's kind of like one of the first times that Joe Rogan like went like real deep in with like some real sounding UFO talk. And
took some real deep bong rips.
It seemed like he was pretty high for it. But Greer and Greer wasn't,
oh Joe Rogan.
No, okay. Drogan. But Greer wasn't that jacked either, by the way, also during that. He seemed like he was like, this is pre weightlifting routine. But
So you're saying Joe Rogan might have turned him on to
May have gotten in on some of those that
hey,
on
man,
it.
You gotta attract
is that what Joe Rogan's doing?
I think
he's trying
may
to
have,
turn all
yeah. I think he may
he's
have buffed
turning
him
disclosure
up,
guys. Disclosure guys are turned into muscle heads because
Listen,
of him to defend themselves.
I'm not trying to start any conspiracy theories here, but I'm just saying Dr. Greer got bigger, got jacked after he was on
Buff Lazar.
So
Buff Lazar's gonna look
those nootropics apparently work, or whatever the fuck those things are that he sells.
But this documentary Unacknowledged, it got him a lot of attention. It was interesting, it's very controversial, but again, it reiterates a lot of what a lot of us already believe about the high-level government secrecy. But remember, the Disclosure Project, this is only half of what motivates Dr. Greer. The other is his involvement in the Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind, those CE5 for short. And thankfully, there is an even newer documentary about him from just 2020. It's called Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind, Contact Has Begun.
Yes.
This is the Dr. Greer content that really interests me, because this guy claims that he can definitely, with his own mind, not only control or contact them, that it's very easy to do, right?
Oh, it sounds super simple. Just be a master meditator.
Yeah, transcendental meditation is super easy. Now, I don't think it's super easy. You need to
just levitate and you know, astral project yourself. Once you figure it out, it's so simple.
You need to practice
this
shit.
Maybe it's just cheap. You don't have to really have to.
No, it sounds so impossible, you guys.
No, it's
no, it doesn't. We're going to find out.
It's expert level yoga, pretty much. Like, you need to be like on a whole nother level spiritually, like your third eye is wide
open.
Look,
I'll do child's pose and hope that I see a firefly.
Yeah, and honestly, that's the best. I'm kind of into it. I'm kind of into it.
All right, well, let's get into it ourselves, because here's the dramatic introduction to this from the very unexpected narrator, Jeremy Piven.
The same people and institutions who lied about ETs and just about everything else are now framing the extraterrestrial presence as a threat.
And we are seriously thinking of the Space Force.
One man has been trying to warn us about this for decades. Most of us are ill-prepared for open contact with an advanced ET civilization. As our expanding cosmology outgrows our theological institutions, modern human society is spiraling into decadence, narcissism, depravity, and nihilism.
Catch me outside, how about that?
If we want to truly understand ETs, their technology, and their intentions, we have to readdress our assumptions about the nature of reality and our relationship with the physical universe.
And rethink everything we think we know.
Who invited her?
Didn't it sound like we threw that soundboard clip in there out of nowhere?
We did not. Cash Me Outside. This is considered the downfall of society. Play soundboard 4. You can tell that's their dramatic music in there.
Cash Me Outside. How about that?
That made me so angry that they made me remember that.
Oh, man. Bahad Bahabi or whatever the hell her name is.
I don't even want to
Bahad Bahabi or whatever.
I'm just going to call her stupid. Stupid.
Well, the great start to this documentary. Way to rip one off, Greer. He starts with Space Force and this guy, but what he's talking about. This is the goal of those secret keepers. Their main thing is that they want to make us fear ET, so they can unite us with Space Force, and we will think that the ETs are bad.
Oh, yeah.
We'll be saying, play it again.
Catch me outside. How about that?
You are doing this on purpose. Oh, I hate this girl so much.
Drea, catch her outside. How about that? If you got a problem
with
her.
Maybe I will. Shit.
Damn.
So this isn't about Catch Me Outside. This is about CE5. So
no, I'm trying to catch some UFOs outside, man. What are you talking about?
Maybe that was code. Sense. That they're putting that in our brain.
Catch them outside right now. Get in your transmedental state and then catch them outside.
I regret.
I like
this
that
now.
Angle.
Yeah, no, just like close your eyes, like sit, cross your legs. And like, just close your eyes
and
then just think
to catch them outside.
Catch me outside. Just imagine that. Send that out into the universe.
Oh, no.
Just don't
this
do a
terrible.
Vision board with her
it's
picture.
Terrible. But before we get too far into that great CEEs, those Close Encounters of the Fifth Kind, they're going to give us a great explanation of what the different classes of encounters are, because there's a lot of them. At least five.
It's five.
Boom.
Close encounters of the first kind consists of visual sightings of an unidentified flying object. Close encounters of the second kind, some physical trace is present, like impressions in the ground or scorched vegetation. Close encounters of the third kind, the occupants or pilots of an ET craft are witnessed. Close encounters of the fourth kind, a human is brought on board an ET craft.
Kissed.
Close encounters of the fifth kind. Proactive, human-initiated communication with extraterrestrial beings. Most of the phenomena presented in this film were photographed or recorded during a CE5 contact event. For thousands of people, contact has begun. This is their story.
These guys have figured it out. Greer's clan, man. While all of us are watching Cash Me Outside, his followers, they're out there and they know how to contact ETs.
Hmm? Well, great. That just, there's two categories then. There's being in an awesome state to contact ETs, and then there's the rest of us are idiots just watching Cash Me Outside, girl.
And you know what else? They all have cell phones and cameras. So it creates for some pretty interesting evidence throughout this documentary, which
they sprinkle a lot of evidence throughout this.
No, catch me. She's done. Oh, okay. She's done. She's done.
Five people.
She's done. But just because you mentioned her again. No. Wait, hold on a second. What is that?
Catch me outside. How about that?
Okay. We're done.
We're done with her now.
But there is, they show a lot of, because yes, of course, all of these CE5 people, they do have their cell phones, and they have a lot of footage of like unexplained aerial phenomenon, and the reaction of the people on the ground filming, it reminded me so much of Gulf Breeze and those Sky Watchers, the warp drive people. Here's a brief clip of one of these CE5 witnesses.
Look, there's four. Holy damn hot shit. Hot dog.
Come on, buddy, don't go away.
Go away. Come on back, Bubba. It's like, I probably would be saying the same thing if I was seeing what they're seeing. I'll admit that, but play Soundboard 5. This one's so good.
Look, there's four.
Four.
That one cracked me up too. There's four, then hot dog.
I mean, admit, that's what you would sound like though if you saw some shit up in the sky. You'd be saying the same hot dog sort all the time. Of shit.
Oh, I would.
I know I would.
I would love to hear it. I think play Soundboard 6. I think I got another one from that too.
Holy damn hot shit.
She had her words a little bit rearranged weird, but
let's not curse in front of the extraterrestrials, okay?
These are our most enlightened transcendental people that somehow we can't reach their level of game. Play it again. We'll never get to this.
Holy damn hot shit.
There's four.
I don't know if you caught it in there too, but they hit like the music from the Steven Spielberg movie. They like played a little motif. They're like do 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 do. They threw that in there in the background.
Well, that's Close Encounters music. They played the ET music on Larry.
They
came,
did play ET. I caught that in the beginning too. I was like, you bastard! How dare you? And then we'll get into it. But ET is also propaganda, by the way, and it works.
It worked on you for really good.
Yes.
That's why Rob's so sucked in. Rob loves this.
Yes. Well, it makes sense. I mean,
these are peaceful. They're having these like peaceful transactions with them. That's why they get so excited. And the whole idea of UFOs is a threat. That is Greer's big disagreement with the narrative about UFOs. He believes that this is being done for nefarious purposes by many known and unknown agencies. And one organization that raised a black flag to Dr. Greer and others in his disclosure project was a group that we are very familiar with.
When I see this thing happening with this To the Stars Academy, where they suddenly appear on the front page of the New York Times, and the CNN all of a sudden wants to talk with them, and they're on MSNBC and all this kind of stuff, I immediately kind of realized, wait a second, this is part of what I've been worried about coming out, because they were constantly spinning this story that this is a threat.
My name is Tom DeLong. A lot of people know me for my band Blink 182. I started that band when I was 16. Through a series of meetings, I was soon connected to a large group of U.S. government officials from the CIA, the Department of Defense, and Lockheed Martin Skunk Works.
Go, Tom.
These guys were the ones involved in the secretive U.S. government programs that dealt with these subjects.
What's happening is the To the Stars Academy people, and what they're doing is they're putting this intense spin. Every single thing they talk about all has this kind of gestalt to it, that this is a threat.
And it very well could be a threat.
It's a threat to our national security.
Where are you?
Tom is a fearmonger, according to these disclosure guys. They are definitely, Dr. Greer's group is definitely opposed to the Stars Academy.
Shots fired. Shots fucking fired,
no
dog.
No kidding. Where are you?
What team are you? Who do you trust in all this?
Man. Hard to say. I was just thinking, if Tom DeLonge is part of the cover-up and he's part of the propaganda, did that make the original Unbelievable Podcast episodes about him also part of the propaganda? Did Brian and Phoebe instigate the propaganda? Are we part of the propaganda?
No, I don't think we're
part of the
propaganda.
I don't work for Greer.
What the fuck is going on?
Look, here's what's going on is like everybody's allowed to have their own, like
sex and beliefs and this, like I said, this is
yeah,
the Greer
verse. Allowed to have
we
their
in.
Own sex. Like, I mean, everybody can be like either super comfortable with the idea or have, you know, their reservations about it and be a little bit just cautious, you know.
But,
and so, I mean, like, ask Brian how he feels about the idea of aliens.
I mean, I'm joking.
So maybe
I'm joking about them being involved in the cover up. But I mean, were you expecting a heel turn from Tom DeLonge, whatever his name is?
People love when you say DeLonge.
DeLonge.
I don't think so. I think it's the people that he's pulled in. Maybe they're people who just didn't want to be in his disclosure group. Like, no, I wouldn't go in this one. We're like, those guys are being controlled.
They make it sound like he's a puppet of them.
And I'm not sure that I believe that necessarily. I think that it's to be automatically ostracized just because you're kind of speaking on a cautious angle, because that's the kind of person I am. I'm very middle of the line. Like, look, I want them to be peaceful and awesome. I want to be peaceful with them back. But there's always that small degree of like apprehension. That's the word I was looking for.
Well, yeah, you've got the fear. You've got the fear because of these organizations.
It's more of a healthy respect.
Alien.
I never got that. Did you guys ever get that from Tom DeLonge and his
they're a threat?
Did you ever get that like the whole thing was that like they're a threat and that we need to be prepared for them because
they're not a threat.
He seems
optimistic.
I never got that impression. It just
Look
seems
the
like
name of the
when they put it through that sort of a lens, it seems more like that, but I never thought that before.
I never got that vibe either.
Tom DeLonge thinks aliens have sunglasses and thrown up peace signs on surfboards and stuff. That's probably what he thinks an alien would be. So yes, I don't think what Greer's group is saying in here.
You know what it is, I think? Tom's thing, wasn't it the secret machines?
Oh,
Cigarette machines.
Whatever it's called. There's no machines involved in Greer's world, right? In the Greer universe. It's all just...
I think these things are a little more... but they have actual ships.
It's not about machines.
Sure.
It ain't about the tech with Greer. Nah. You know what I mean? Nah. It's not about that shit at all.
Like, either way, Tom's all about disclosure also, so I don't know why...
And the tech.
Greer's
and he's all about the tech.
He's saying...
Yeah.
But he's saying that Tom DeLonge group, that they're controlled by all these other shadow organizations. And one of the ways that these organizations are spreading fear concerning aliens, making Drea a little apprehensive, is through staged alien abductions. One of the people who claims knowledge of these human orchestrated alien abductions is none other than Richard Doty. You guys remember Richard Doty? He was the government PSYOP agent from Mirage Men.
Fucking Doty. Of course I remember
fucking
this
Doty,
guy.
Of course it's in here. So here is Doty explaining that alien abductions have been staged.
We did do that, yes. OSI did that. There was a special group out of the 7602nd Air Intel Wing at Fort Belvoir that came out and did that. They had these people that had maybe some sort of defects, anatomical defects that were brought in to fool people and thinking they're aliens. Yeah. I can't give you any specifics because the program is still classified and they're probably still doing it. I wouldn't doubt it. They were still doing it.
I don't believe him. Deformed people or whatever he said, defective people.
Antonomical defects, I think he
working
said.
For the government to pretend to abduct people.
Admit it, though. That does sound like it could work.
It sounds like
work.
Something they would do. I mean, look, I was watching some programs on, you know, like mysteries at the museum and stuff like that, where they were like, let's just say even the whole thing about World War II, where they were sending out like or acting like, oh, the U.S. has totally developed ESP technology and everything, and like we can send messages to somebody all the way across the world. And then the Russians jumped on it, just dunked a bunch of money into it, and wasted their time. I don't think that it's above the U.S. government to do something petty, to just to orchestrate.
Where are they getting these people with these defects to just wheel out for their little like bullshit abductions? You know what I mean?
Why didn't he just say we had Hollywood makeup people make aliens to do it? He's like, no, we found a deformed guy. Well, what, that look like a wrinkly alien? Like, where did those guys come from? There's no guy that looks like
that. It would be more believable if it was a real body than if it was made of prosthetics.
This reminded me of Tom Reed a little bit, because how he kind of always alludes that it's like, he's like, I never said I was abducted by aliens. You know what I mean?
His whole thing of
like, I never said that.
Covering his tracks.
Maybe he was one of the, like, maybe that shit that went down, you know, with Tom Reed in that little town could have been one of the focus areas of one of these places where they brought out some of their defective people with their alien people that they have.
So the government pulls up to a circus and they're like, yeah, I'll take a lobster boy, I'll take alligator girl, I'll take this, whatever this
tall
thing is.
That guy looks like a mantis. Let's definitely get him. We need him to jerk off in the corner, 100%.
You're onto something though, Russ. I mean, there are those, you know, those circus sideshows. They probably did pick up those people. I wouldn't be surprised.
Just one really fat alien. He's just like the they're like, I don't know what kind of species is that.
Female alien. Yeah.
Circuses are not only supplying our cryptids through their constant train wrecks, they're also supplying our aliens through their menagerie of oddballs.
And giving them jobs, yes.
I don't even want to know what the fuck he is talking about. Like, what is he alluding to, dude?
It's like a sloth guy. So,
how many times did they do that? How many times did they wheel some poor person out?
We got to get Doty on the show, though. Be like, come on.
But I love
how
he's also like, here's all of these details about what we did, but I can't get into specifics. Like, dude, you already did, man.
You already are.
You already are getting into specifics. Just keep
going.
That
is one of those little black flags. And they're like, oh, but I can't. But I did.
But I don't know. I kind of believe that guy. I believe everybody in this documentary.
Yeah, I think you do. You believe both sides. It's just
fucking
totally impossible.
They got me, man. I'm totally in here.
But see, Stephen Greer, though, he's not worried about that. If you want to make contact with actual aliens, not deformed government agents or some kind of even hologram made by an intelligence agency, you have to do it through your consciousness. Remember Greer, he's the transcendental meditation instructor, meditating, quieting the mind. This is the key to many abilities that some consider to be unnatural.
For example, the ability to levitate, teleport, dematerialize, rematerialize, bilocate, trilocate, go through solid objects. These are all things that develop spontaneously as you enter into deeper and deeper and higher states of consciousness, precognition, telepathy.
And these were not considered exotic phenomena. These were considered abilities that were available to the experienced meditator. It's just part of quieting your mind, part of the practice, and it's all available.
It sounds like the crime squad. I need to start meditating. Like everything he listed, I think we've found a human who does that. So maybe they're on to something.
Yeah. I thought it was interesting how, I mean, it makes sense that there is just this level that maybe we've forgotten about over time where, like, no, that's not like a supernatural thing. That's something that we all have an innate ability to do, but you guys just got dumber over time. Like, it hurts my
came
feelings.
Back to cash me outside again. That's what
no,
happened. All our abilities.
That's not what I'm talking about. God damn it.
He's talking about is he talking about your physical body doing these things, or is he talking about being able to do it on like that, like Doctor Strange, like level?
Yes, you have to guess. We got to put it in that terms. You got to go with the Doctor. I don't know. I think he's talking about phasing out of the physical world and beep and booping in and out and stuff like that.
He doesn't do that at all in this documentary.
No. Well, you guys remember when we were talking about all the like unbelievable humans and the whole like quote unquote levitating, but really they were just like jumping across the field.
The bunny hop thing, yeah. On
their
knees.
And so that kind of, it just kind of makes me feel like if I were one of those people and then I hear something like that, I'm like, well, maybe we just like have devolved over time. If people used to be able to actually levitate and we're just inferior now, like what the hell?
They're like, they're on the right. They're like kind of on the right path, but they're just a little bit off. They need to just meet up with Stephen Greer and hear what he's talking about.
Like a carrot in front of a horse. They're just trying to lead them on. That's
their TV was much different. It was teaching them much different things. But Dr. Greer, he also seems very interested in integrating consciousness and technology, which is an idea I like a lot. And this is something that science has experimented with for decades. He explains that aliens have also been doing this, but for much, much longer with much more impressive results.
interstellar civilizations are using consciousness-assisting technologies and technologies that assist their own consciousness, both, in all their travel and communication systems. The central operating system for any interstellar competent civilization is the science of consciousness and all the physics that go with that.
I hate how sure he sounds about all of this, because I believe he believes it. And I got to ask, am I being tricked again?
I don't know,
probably,
man.
No, I wouldn't say tricked maliciously.
If you're listening to this and you haven't sparked up a doobie or hit the bong or something by this point, do it now, because I think you kind of need to get on the right level to really fully understand what Stephen Greer is talking about.
Oh, man. Just down that coffee. You're doing fine, too.
I was keyed into this stuff. Yeah.
This is when they started to get me, because they show a lamp that changes color, like whatever color you were thinking. They have this like consciousness lamp. And in the documentary, the lamp turns red and they look at each other and they're like, yeah, I was thinking about red and it was red. And but meanwhile, aliens, they're blinking through dimensions by just thinking about it. And yeah, they're just like, they blink through and they're like, yeah, Earth. I mean, I totally like, and the Earth, that's where we were going. I think just they have picture, a similar thing going on.
Yeah, I think that's a little bit of a stretch to how simple he made it sound. Like, just be really good at thinking and picturing it and it'll just happen. Like, I don't know, man. I think that a lot more people would be doing this stuff if that were the case.
Well, how did he phrase it? He said something like they're using technology that they use on a spiritual level, but it also spiritual technology on a technical level or something like that.
It sounded like he phrased it
was kind of confusing, but like, what is that? It's like next level VR sort of like, what is, I don't even know.
It's consciousness manipulating technology.
It's just like
connected to their tech. Like they're one with the technology kind of.
And yeah. Speaking of technology, we have to mention though, that he is in Batman's garage.
Yes.
From Christopher Nolan's Batman.
So
nearly
glad
the entirety.
You, so glad
the entirety
you noticed that too.
Of this documentary. Cause I've seen that same garage. It's in a lot of music videos and stuff too.
I did
and
research.
Stephen Greer is sitting. Yes. He's okay. Let's hear.
It's called the Lightbox Garage. It's in LA.
Yes.
It's a popular filming location. They film music videos there all the time. But when you put Stephen Greer in there and have him cross his legs and do some crazy meditation, that place has a whole different vibe than it did in those Batman movies. But
there's no Greer Mobile or anything. There's no Alfred.
It does seem like maybe he is Batman in a way, that like he's taken over Batman's garage because he's got the muscles for it. You know what I mean?
Okay, look, we would recognize, you know, Batman's mask cuts off everything but the mouth.
Have you ever seen Batman and Greer in the same place at the same time?
Have you ever seen Greer's face?
He's got that jaw, though. I could see him being an older Batman. But he's like consciousness Batman. Like, why did we have to live in that universe where we got meditating Batman? Like, not punching Batman. We got meditating Batman in our universe. But I got to say, some of that CE5 stuff is impressive. They show a lot of footage of CE5. Some is very cool. Some are clearly rods. You got to admit, some of these CE5s videos you see, they look like rods. Some are probably just planes.
There's a lot.
What did you guys think of this footage, Drea? What did you think of the footage?
A lot of them I thought were just like little like light flares catching off of buttons or something. And then like when the camera moves, because all of them were moving in the exact same, like they were synchronized. And that usually happens with like light trails when the camera moves. And it could have been, sure, maybe it was a weird point of light that just showed up out of nowhere and then the camera moved. But everything else was just as bright around. I don't know.
There was, you know what? I agree with you, Drea. There was a few videos that there was that kind of thing going on where you're like, whatever is moving there, it's moving with the camera. You can feel, you can tell it's moving with the lens of the camera.
Yeah.
So you're like, that's not, this is bullshit. But then there's other ones that aren't like that, that were very like shit that I've never seen anything like before. This documentary, if you like that, like the footage of
shaky footage, just
shaky footage of stuff, there's really good shaky footage in this documentary. And like some stuff I've never, the one of the triangle that shits out the little pyramid of trials.
Oh yeah, some those videos for sure. I was like, look, I've seen
so,
a lot of those.
It's
dumb
so
fake ones.
Zoomed in. It's so like over zoomed in. This guy to try to get it, he was so zoomed in, and then a perfect triangle of little ones comes out, and it just is like it's something that would be so hard to create on the computer. Mm-hmm. Fake.
I think Rob's life has been changed by watching this.
I thought it was really cool. I thought I don't know if you noticed, but I love this shit. I love this sort of shit. But there was one video that I've seen before that pisses me off, which just looks like a blurry footage of some white balloons in the wind. And I did see that one, and I was like, fuck that one. Come on.
That's a filler
one. Shouldn't
have
made it in there.
But you can do this. you guys can see this, because calling these ETs, it does sound kind of easy, the way Dr. Greer describes it. You meditate for 30 minutes, you zoom in to wherever you are in relation to space, and you zoom in to where your present location is, you grab your shitty phone camera, and that's about it. I have the steps right?
Yeah, that's exactly it. You have to know exactly where you are relative to other celestial bodies in the entire universe, and that's easy.
Yeah. And you do a blow up of yourself. You go all the way down yourself, and then you just get your phone out. And one of the practitioners of CE5 producing, that's what they call it, producing, is a man named Jim Martin, who was able to summon an orb with his mind.
It was Christmas morning, December 2016. I was on my porch having coffee when I saw this incredible double-staged orb flying through the air. I was following this object upward, and I went right up like it was going to pass out of my line of sight. When I asked the object, please turn back around, I didn't want the experience to end. Amazingly, it stopped, changed direction, then headed back downward. That was truly profound to me, that I could meditate, send my thought into the universe, and then have a visual response in the sky to confirm that we are interacting with each other.
Having coffee, filming UFOs, making them do whatever you want. It sounds so relaxing.
I'm not sure. I mean, it's nice to think about, you know, that it intercepted his thoughts out of all of the different people on the planet that could have been seeing them. And the way it looked like they just kind of realized that they forgot something and they had to go
like
back.
Like when you forget your mask when you go into like the deli, you have to like run back. I was like, oh, God damn it.
They realized, like, you go to McDonald's and they're like, fuck, they forgot the fries. How do you get to go?
I thought it was more like... Play Soundboard 4. I thought they were all like, what'd that guy say to me? And they said,
catch me outside. How about that?
They were not having it. Because, yeah. They're like, you got to stop calling us, dude. It's the third time this week. Because this is not the only strange light that Jim Martin was able to film. He would summon even more fantastic orb formations.
In October 2018, we had the biggest sighting I've seen yet in Long Beach, California. My girlfriend and I were in the backyard when we saw this huge white object in the sky. This was different than most of the normal orbs I filmed. This object was elongated and almost looked like a moving portal in the sky. Amazingly, once I got the camera on it, an incredible triangle formation of orbs shot out of this main object, and I captured it on film. You can hear how excited I am in the film to see this again, this triangle formation, for the third time.
What the fuck is that thing? Wow. Holy shit.
So profound. Wow. Yeah, this guy's seen so much stuff, but even this impresses him to say something like that.
Well, yeah. I mean, I think, was that the footage you were
this,
talking about,
this
Rob?
Is the guy. This is exactly what I was just talking about.
I was pretty astounded myself.
This is one of the coolest shots I've ever seen as far as like UFO footage goes, because it is... It's very strange. The way he describes it as like a portal, or like it's long, like a vortex or something. That part is like fascinating. Cause what could that be? Is that like some sort of a mothership that's containing these things? Is that like one end of a wormhole from fucking the other side of the galaxy or something? Like, what could that be? It's insane.
The things they describe in here, it makes it seem like these are just objects that are just temporarily somehow using the same field that we are on, just for that brief time. But these larger ones, I don't know, man. It's like an expanding rod cave or something is opening up. Like,
he's
calling this thing, though. He is calling these things. That's the thing. That's what Jim Martin, he's a CE5 producer. He made this event happen, according to Greer.
You know, I really would love...
It looked like flares. I'm going to say it looked like... This one looked like flares.
Really? Like, you're thinking that looked like flares?
Some of them look like... Then maybe not this. I don't know. A little
this
bit
didn't
like...
Look
I think
like
it could
flares,
be done
dude.
With flares.
Because flares, know, like, man. Fall, and then they... Like, there's a certain way that they behave, but these ones, like... The way they like spit out and then they make this formation and then stay. Because we've all seen the video. Yeah, we've all seen the video of, you know, the night like skydivers where they have flares and how they can make those formations. But they're moving at a kind of a constant rate. They don't stop and then, you know, vanish and then make a different. I don't know.
This shit is so high up in the sky.
Yeah.
When he's filming it, he zooms in so far to try to see this thing that they're basically little pixels. It's blurry because... Obviously, it's blurry. It's always blurry. But
of course. But what if these people, they can call these UFOs at will, they get a nice camera
the way
and
that
sit
these,
there.
The way that these dots appear from the thing and form a symmetrical triangle just below it is very strange. I'll leave it at that. It's it is unnatural, cool is what it
yeah.
looks
okay.
like.
I can, right. That's a good safe statement. Yes. Yeah.
But Dr. Greer, he's on a even further level than your Jim Martins. His abilities extend beyond just summoning orbs and rods. He has communicated directly with ETs. In 1973, while meditating in the mountains of North Carolina, he saw a flying saucer above. And then a strange deer appeared next to him. But this was no normal deer.
And I went, what is that doing here? You know, and I realized it wasn't a deer, and it actually appeared and then dematerialized, came over and touched me on the right shoulder. And when it touched my right shoulder, I could actually see my ski jacket indent, and all my hair stood on end. It was like this electromagnetic pulse, and I had long hair, and it was going, ding. At that instant, I vanished off the mountaintop onto the ship, and then we were, bang, almost instantly out in space. So at that point, I stayed in this meditative state and was teaching the ETs what it was like to be in that state of consciousness, but also be a boy, a young man on Earth. They were very interested in this. And then we kind of merged together in our meditation, and I created with them this protocol for making contact with them.
Dr. Greer schooling aliens on TM. What do you think about that, Drea?
I think it just, like, the whole thing is kind of cute. It reminds me of, like, when I first picked up the parking lot cat and brought him into my apartment. Because it's like, oh, hey, little buddy, come over here for a minute. Why don't you check out my apartment? But instead, it's like this weird deer-like creature that's just like, ding, now you're on my ship. And it seems cute and innocent, and it's nice and optimistic, at least.
He, and Rob, in 94, he's telling Larry King, we need some kind of liaison figure. It's like this is 1973. It's like, well, didn't you teach aliens how to do meditation and get on, I don't know, the same vibration as, I don't know what he did.
Good so
he's,
point,
he's claiming
Russ.
It.
His story kind of has advanced quite a bit since his Larry David appearance. Since
I would love to see that.
Since his appearance on that television show. But yeah, man, I don't know. I love the idea that, like, he's like, I'm on the mountain, one sec, and then instantly I'm in the ship. And he's like, and in the corner, there's a tall guy with a white goatee who just keeps ejaculating into a bowl for some reason.
That was a different thing. He didn't see that.
Thankfully, he did it. But it did feel like
that's an interesting point, though. It's like he kind of seems to talk about all extraterrestrials as if they all are going to follow the same protocol that he established this one time.
And yeah, he opened like the up same. The gate. Yeah, he opened up whatever the Stargate of communication
like that.
Mentally.
He set the ground rules with them right there. That's pretty
sure,
cool.
Sure, with one species, like, I don't know.
Well, it's not about
species.
But
according to him, there is only the one civilization. They're just called aliens, I think. Or maybe they are different ones.
No,
he doesn't say
how
that.
How can this protocol be established to contact every single, you know,
he figured
extraterrestrial
it out.
There is?
And we'll figure okay. it out, too.
Well, I mean, he gets into
this
it.
As just... Yeah, he started this as just a one-man thing. This was just him on a mountain in North Carolina. But then in France, just 2 years later, he did it with a group of people, and it worked then, too. He did summoning and vectoring. That's when you do the meditation where you picture where you are. He also claimed that in the 90s, he tried this in England, and a crop circle appeared. It looked it looked like one of the worst ones we've seen, but it was a crop circle that he did, you know, do an experiment on.
Wait,
where
are
he,
you sure he, it was it a crop circle and it wasn't
wheat.
A...
Wheat circles.
Wasn't a wheat circle.
It probably was a wheat circle. I think he might have misspoken in this. Let's put that in the blunders of this one. But while they have footage of strange orbs and discs, they also are able to capture images of alien beings during these CE5 sessions. And Dr. Greer, he's going to explain why we can see them aliens.
We're dealing with civilizations where almost every aspect of how they appear in our time space would look like magic to us. And in the CIA, this is actually called WSFM. Sounds like a radio station. It stands for Weird Science and Frickin' Magic. A spacecraft can be completely 3D like you see a solid aircraft. It can be partially in this dimension, but shifted mostly into another dimension. And all that we will detect in this dimension might be an electronic signature, orb, or an object that appears and flashes in and out, a scintillation of light that then vanishes, or an object that comes in where it looks almost like a hologram, of an ET being that will be standing amongst us, but it's an electronically teleported version of that conscious being. I love this one. His name is Bijou. He's an interstellar being from Andromeda, and he has a very bright looking nose because there is a orb here that teleported him onto the site.
Hi, Bijou. Yes, it's Bijou, the Cajun Andromedan. Bijou the alien with a very shiny nose.
Yeah, this image kind of freaked me out. I didn't like it.
I love Bijou.
Yeah, he shows images of actual aliens that have appeared because of the CE5 sessions. And I got to say, wouldn't this also explain Bigfoot and every other cryptid, too, that they're also talked about as these interdimensional beings that can, you know, pop in and out of our world? Couldn't this be Mothman? Couldn't this be everything?
Interesting
theory. Is Greer going to take over all of the paranormal with this theory?
Interesting theory.
Well, I guess
it's WSFM, man.
Weird science and freaking magic. I guess my take on that, if that's to be true, like that maybe it can manifest in the way that we're imagining them based off of like the images that we've compiled over the years, like through media, through photographs, whatever.
So it's gonna be a nightmare in 20 years.
I don't know if that's how it works.
As far as people trying to summon Bigfoot and then like, we saw Bigfoot, you know, like, well, maybe it could be an alien being like, oh, they think we look like this, let's just be that to them.
People are gonna be summoning Pokemon in like 20 years. Like, things are gonna be weird or cryptid. Yeah,
what do you think Bijou is? What do you think Bijou is then? You think Bijou's like a leprechaun
guy? He looks like a little Cajun leprechaun.
Kind of got a leprechaun like pixie thing going on.
One little Martian guy from the Hanna-Barbera cartoons.
Who is the Great Gazoo? Is that what you're talking about?
I think so.
Maybe. Kind of did have a little bit
the
of
green
like a
guy.
He is like a little frolicking little, like, looks like a little troublemaker.
He looks,
Bijou.
Yeah, he looks like a little elf.
Oh, Bijou. Yeah. I love
him. Andromedan Cajun imp. Yeah. but stay in our pictures. Very cute. This meditation and consciousness altering that Dr. Greer has pioneered, it is considered dangerous to those shadowy organizations, those Tom DeLongs and whoever else is the dark forces. You'll never find him. Because somehow his consciousness will give you seemingly unlimited power.
When a critical mass of people, and whether it's 1% or a fraction of that, depends on the state of consciousness of those who are practicing the meditation, or a prayer, or coherence. But at that point, you can shift an entire civilization. If we all become coherent, just 1% of us, like a molecule of helium, and we become aligned and coherent and move in the right direction, it will transform the other 99%, even though they don't know that we're doing it. And that's the beauty and the power of the structure of non-locality and consciousness, is that it's all interwoven, but there's enormous power when you're operating at that deeper level of consciousness. And that the intelligence community is very much afraid of, because that's something, A, they cannot control, and B, it would transcend their ability to alter the outcome.
It's the 1% versus the 1%. The enlightened versus the elite. And while everyone else is just walking around clueless to whatever is supposed to happen. Do you think we'll ever get to that point, Rob, where 1% of the population become hardcore CE5ers?
I mean, man, like we said in the beginning of the episode, I think he needs to get a better understanding of humans first before he starts getting into the aliens, because that shit ain't ever going to happen. You can't get 50 people to all have the same opinion and do something at the same time. So, yeah, I don't know, man. This is like, I would love to think that it's possible someday, because I do think that maybe there is something to CE5, but I don't know if it's achievable in the way that he is trying to do it. I don't know. And how does he know that that's going to work? How does he know
that? I have another point about this, Drea. I always thought it was supposed to be 2% of the population had to become enlightened for aliens to show up. I know we've heard this before. Did Greer just lower the bar? He's like, oh, no, it's only 1%. Who said 2%?
I think so. I mean, we got to think about how much population has boomed since maybe that first forecast was thrown out there. But also, I mean, we just don't know. You know, the 2% was just a projection. The 1% is a projection. Clearly, we're not even at 1%. So I think it's fair to set the bar at a slightly more achievable, although Rob thinks it's unachievable.
I don't know.
I mean, isn't it like 75 million people? Or like, what didn't he say? Isn't it some crazy number? That's
it is
like
a pretty high number. There's a lot of people here.
It's pretty high.
So yeah. I don't know, man. And what does that consist of? It consists of everybody meditating simultaneously, basically?
No, that's going to be the hard part, is scheduling it.
I don't think it's a scheduling issue, but if you don't think that this blissful future of CE5 meditation is possible, I'm going to stop you right there. Because the conclusion to this two-hour docu-journey into the world of Greer will show how even you can learn the famed CE5 protocols, thus saving humanity from Tom DeLonge and his puppet masters.
So anybody can do it, no matter where you're from, you know, what background. You can just learn the protocols. We have a lot of friends from around the world who never been on one of these expeditions, and they just go online and use the protocols and apply them and have wonderful experiences.
I'm practicing CE5 in Cambridgeshire, United Kingdom.
Colorado Springs.
Creston, British Columbia, Canada.
Geraldton, Western Australia.
Butterville, North Carolina.
Lexington, Michigan.
Moorhead, Kentucky.
Vancouver Island.
And Shelton, Washington.
New Zealand.
The CE5 will just test the mass amazing out of
Melbourne, Australia.
Riverdale, Georgia.
People from all walks of life are becoming interstellar ambassadors and experiencing transcendent states of consciousness in union with these beings. Thousands are making contact by simply using the guided meditation in the CE5 Contact app.
That's it! There a it crummy is. Commercial for an app! All we need to do to raise human consciousness, meet aliens, defeat the global elite, is to get Stephen Greer's CE5 app. I'm not sold. Black flag. Did you guys look at this app at all? Do you know even how much this thing costs, Rob?
I don't know.
This app costs $9.99. If you want to get full global enlightenment, you got to drop $10.
Expensive. That's a little expensive, Stephen. Come on. What are you doing,
bro?
You
want the CE5 protocols? Look, I want to say this. Skyfish protocol is free and will always be free. I will always make sure that it's free. But no, CE5, $9.99. This was a two-hour infomercial.
Oh, my God. Wow. I know. I felt so cheap at the end of it. Well, also because I can't afford $9.99 for an app. Are you kidding me?
And Greer couldn't even say it himself.
You should. I know. I didn't mention it in there. You should create the Skyfish Protocol app for free and have it contend against
it. Oh, it'll definitely be free. Yeah, absolutely.
See who's going to get more downloads and who ends up making actual cash off of this.
It does take like a weird cultish turn at the end there where it's like, join the movement, the CE5 movement.
Yeah, dude, like, doesn't it sound like he's trying to get you to sign up for, like, you can be a Mary Kay salesperson, like the way he called it, like, you too can be
an ambassador,
galactic ambassador. Yeah,
I want to be like, all right, how much does it cost for the for the little license that they give you, the little,
you get a title, they're gonna send you a little certificate
and a t-shirt. Yeah,
they probably don't even get it. You gotta print it yourself. Here is the closing pitch of the CE5 app infomercial mentory from narrator Jeremy Piven.
People from all walks of life are becoming interstellar ambassadors and experiencing transcendent states of consciousness in union with these beings. Thousands are making contact by simply using the guided meditation in the CE5 Contact app. It's up to the children of Earth to become active participants in the unfolding of our universe and not leave it to the power elite. Once we reach a critical mass of people, a coherent and enlightened minority can transform the rest of humanity instantly.
Man, what a letdown. If Greer cared so much, why is there an overpriced app involved at all? I'm not getting tricked this time. And I got to say, this sucks because I like a lot of the sentiment behind this. The TM, the disclosure. I like Bijou, but I can't get on board. I can't get on board with the CE5 because of this.
I felt the same way. Like when I first started watching this, I was like, all right, cool. I'm all on board. He's making a lot of sense with the disclosure. And then we hit that halfway point where it starts to turn into like the power of our minds and our deeper levels of consciousness and how much effect that has. And then if you really want to unlock your true potential, sign up for this shit. I'm like, son of a bitch.
Yeah, no. I was going to ask, but I guess, is that you got any final thoughts? Is that it, Drea? You want to close the book on Greer with that?
It is. It's that I agree with all the stuff he had to say. It's just that you're totally right, where if he truly had his heart in this, the app would be free.
For sure. And how about you, Rob? You getting that app? You saving the world?
Oh, man. I am on the fence right now. I'm about to go to the app store and check it out, possibly. But I don't know, man. I don't know. You know what? It's it's a tough situation because in the documentary, there is some other interesting stuff that we didn't really get a chance to talk about. Like there's a guy who was like deaf and he has this experience by doing the CE5 that he claims cures his deafness and that he had since he was a kid. And there's also like a couple of other things where like there's one experience that they have where they have a picture of this pyramid faced alien that shows up, this entity or being that is like literally like Pyramid Head from Silent Hill.
Yeah.
And
look,
it's like
I had
illuminated.
To pick one alien.
I know.
I had to pick one alien. I figured to go with Bijou for the show, but there are others out there.
We can't do like a 2.5 hour long episode about a 2 hour long documentary. I understand, but there was some interesting stuff in this documentary that was probably better than most documentaries, I would say. The music, I gotta also mention, the music in this documentary sets it off. Like, they use that one meme song what is it? Like, they use that, and I was like, all right, this is a banger. This is kind of sick.
Shoot,
and
I forget who that is.
They had like a sick synth wave jam in the beginning.
They'll do CE5 video montages where they'll close up on the alien's head. It'll dance around a little. Some great hip music.
It's cool. Get really high first.
Honestly, yeah. Get baked and watch this documentary. That's my final thoughts. I think it's cool. Stephen Greer is cool in my book, even though he's a little bit of a huckster with his app. Yeah, it is a little shitty. Because you're right. It would make it a lot easier for people to get in on this if it was free. But whatever.
It's not, man. No. Let's just worry about the skyfish. But be sure and answer this week's poll. And I don't know. What should it be? Should it be, would you buy the app? Or should it be, what's the best way to contact alien beings? You want to do that one? Maybe it could be like buy the app, become an astronaut, get abducted, leave a ball out, other, something like that.
What's the best way to contact aliens? CE5.
Best way to initiate.
Put a ball outside. I don't know.
Get abducted, become an astronaut.
I don't know.
Be deformed. That'll be on there too. But that's it. Let's get out.
To telepath messages through the vast unknown, please close your eyes and concentrate with every thought you think upon the recitation we're about to say. Calling occupants of interplanetary craft. Calling occupants.
Yeah, the Carpenters were down with the Greer stuff too, it sounds like.
Holy crap.
Interesting.
I've never heard that before.
That was
it's a really cool song. If Karen Carpenter's still around, she would definitely been at his side.
I think I would really like to think so. I'm a big Karen Carpenter fan.
And Rob, I think, is a big Greer fan, huh?
Obviously. I like it. And it's not just because of the muscles, okay? I know I can already see
the
comments.
Yeah, you're the one
who nominated him. I can already see the comments of everybody being like, Rob's got a crush on Stephen Greer or whatever they're going to say.
Oh, they may or may not be correct. 100%.
Yeah, maybe it's true. Maybe it's not. Whatever. But I'm just saying, he's interesting. And like, I don't know, like I'm kind of scared to try CE5 because like, first off, what if it does work? Number one.
Did you get the app during this little...
No, I'm still thinking about it. But I've been... Fence. Even before, because the funny thing is, when I was a kid, man, I remember looking up at the sky and, like, kind of thinking about this sort of stuff, being like, maybe, like, they can hear my thoughts out there. Maybe there is something out there. I was kind of onto this guy's thing, like, even when I was a kid looking up at looking for UFOs. And I remember being like, it's one of those things where, like, you think that a star could be a UFO, but it might just be your eyes playing tricks on you. It looks like things are moving up there. So I used to always convince myself that I was seeing UFOs up in the sky. So like, I don't know. I kind of want to go on one of these trips on like this expedition with Dr. Greer. I don't know how much that would cost me if I wanted to do that.
I know Stephen Greer has a pretty vast website. And Dre, I think you've got that up. So why don't you tell us about some kind of CE5 events? What can we actually go do?
If you're feeling like scared, Rob, you can start off as just a witness and just you can just watch some witness testimonies and then Dr. Greer's comments after. And side note, this information has never been seen before this, apparently, by anyone. And I think you'd be able to afford it if you can afford a $9.
Wait, is this on the app or is this in person? What is this?
What do you mean witness?
Like watch a video?
Yeah. You just get to witness the witnesses testifying, I guess.
I'm going to say I would say that's probably got to be, what is that, like $25 or something? What do you think?
Close.
Rob?
$50 maybe, if to be a witness.
Oh man! All right, if we were playing Prices Right, I think Russ would take it because it's $29.
Okay, $29. That's it to just go watch Stephen Greer be watched by other people.
To be a witness.
All right, yeah. So you're kind of on the outside.
Under $30, and you don't get to experience shit. You just get to witness.
Where is that?
I don't know. That's the weird part too.
Like, he does conferences. He does like big group conferences every year.
It must show be clips. A traveling circus.
They show clips from it, and I love the clips of him giving the speeches at the conferences, yeah. Talking about.
I was like,
the
it
aliens.
Could be live testimonies, but it just sounds kind of boring. Like for $30, I would really want to do more. Like maybe you can, if you're feeling a little bit bolder, go a little bit into the either in depth or in practice with CE5. And this is either a 4-hour session where you just get the quote unquote true deep dive into the practice and why it's so important.
Okay.
Which I think we kind of got through the documentary.
This sounds like more like what I want to go on. This is like what I'm interested in. How much is
you
this
might be interested
me?
In the, well, it's about double the witnessing.
That's it. It's not that bad.
That's it. Just to be involved is just like, what is it, about $100 to do that?
No, $59. It's like, it's about double. It's
this is doable. Oh, yeah, it's okay.
Dude, mind. I think. Rob, I think you'd be interested in the evening session.
How is it that the app is $10 and to actually do the shit in person is just $50? It seems
because it's guided. You have the doctor with you himself. It says that it's he's peaceful. He initiates peaceful contact and you're actually with him.
I guess, you know, and I had said that I'm scared because like, what if it does, what if it does work and I get astrally projected onto a spaceship or like, there's this one, he tells this one story about this guy who's like, does his first astral projection and he floats out there and he bumps into a spaceship. He just bumps into a spaceship in space and the aliens look at him and they're like, the fuck is your problem, dude? And like, this guy's first time astral projector over here. And then they just like send him off on his way. But they do make a point to say throughout the documentary several times in bold letters, no one has been injured doing CE5.
They have
no
to
one
their
has
man.
Been
liabilities.
Injured.
No human has
of.
Ever been harmed.
Yes, no like, human has ever been harmed using CE5.
By the ETs, but maybe psychologically they could have been harmed. Like maybe they end up estranged from their spouse, or they lose the respect of their children, or they lose their jobs.
What,
do
they
don't
disappear
know
in space? That's why they don't know where these people are, because it's just doing. No, this Greer event, I know that these are things. I know he's got to have some kind of big Cadillac thing, right?
Oh,
like
man.
A big money thing. So can I have the description of that? Because I want to try to
this
guess
includes,
Rob on this.
First of all,
meet and greet.
Includes,
it's got to have a meet and greet.
Well, I mean, it's better. It's attendance to the VIP after party.
Now we're talking.
Which is after the premiere movie and VIP seating, which, come on, that's already sells itself. You also get a 1-year subscription to the annual Cosmic membership for you or as a gift. I don't get that. No. And a personalized autographed copy of Extraterrestrial Contact, The Evidence and Implications, for you to take home. Oh. This is quite a bit more...
With
the
Stephen Greer is there, and you get to watch a movie, VIP after party, you get to rub
and
elbows.
And a luxury venue, 30 other VIP attendees, you get to get all schmoozy and
this
yeah. What
awesome.
What do you think this is going to cost? Though?
I'm going to say this has got to be what $800.
Oh wow, you're really
like,
going
this is
high.
A big one.
You're really going
what
big.
What do you think, Rob?
I'm thinking I like 500. I think 500 is a little bit more.
I don't think you'll have like. I don't think y'all have the guts to handle Dr. Greer's.
What is he doing?
$1,250.
Holy shit, dude.
That's a lot of apps right there.
Ambassador package. It says limit 10, but it also says you get 30 other VIP attendees. So I don't really know how that math works out.
He's really gatekeeping these aliens on many levels, it seems. It's like, even on the lowest level, it takes $10 to get in just to be able to help humanity. You just want to help humanity.
But
if you really want to help humanity, you can, you know.
Think about it like this, though. What's, like, the worst thing that can happen? If, like, say you don't have an alien experience, you're still getting, like, a very calming, soothing. You're getting a very calming, soothing, spiritual, meditative experience. You know what I mean?
Replaced by the stress of losing close to $1,300.
And then all the rage that's going to come afterwards when you realize it, and you're like, oh man, I should have just gone with Tom DeLonge.
Meditation is good.
You could have just hung out with Christo, and like, he's really down to earth and wants to give this stuff away for free. He just wants to experience it and share it with people. I didn't expect Dr. Greer to come out with this kind of kind of scummy, like,
capitalist. He quit being a doctor a long time ago, so maybe the ethics went with
maybe
it.
Maybe he should go back into part-time ET trauma shit. Okay.
I think he's looking at the bigger picture.
ER,
okay,
not
guys?
ET.
No, I did that on purpose.
Listen, okay, I got you.
Guys, you're just looking at the right now of the situation. You're looking at how he's charging money for it right now, but time is relative. This is interstellar we're talking.
Money
time
is
a flat circle.
Just let go.
Okay, so really what he's building towards here is to really get his movement off the ground, the CE5 movement, to get everyone to simultaneously meditate at the same time. This is kind of like, remember the people we were talking about earlier, the ones who tried to meditate by hopping? They got like, we talked about how they got like 1,000 of them to try to do it at once. And
how much do you think they paid to get together to hop?
I mean, probably money involved in that as well, but I don't know. I'm not ready to shit on Dr. Greer.
Sure.
I'm shaping
up to be his protege. So
I'm a little bit confused by the app and by, like the pricing of the events and stuff seems reasonable in my opinion.
What?
To have that sort of an experience with the guy who wrote the book on CE5.
Look,
I mean,
okay, when they say attendance at the VIP after party, they don't even say if it includes drink tickets, bottle service, food, none of that.
Just imagine when you get back there, he's in his fucking tank top, just popping bottles of champagne. This is
a fucking sick party.
That shit would be fun. Come on.
Russ is
having a hard time over there.
Not with these people are about at all. This is not that really, kind of party. I wish it was. It might be more.
I'm not in the financial bracket to really see that as worth it. In any capacity?
Oh, I don't know.
Go for it, please, by all means.
I do want to have an experience. Like, the shit that they talk about in this documentary, it looks fun. First off, they're all hanging out around campfires. That looks pretty cool. That looks like a fun time to just hang out around
campfire. That's easy. I would pay $60 to do that, maybe.
You know that they're probably passing something around. So it's also, you know,
they're not doing that.
Probably are. You got to open your fucking third eye, dude.
And
there's only one way to do that sometimes. So I'm just saying, they probably are getting cool, you know. Like smoking.
They
would have
put that in a documentary. And look, I'm gonna give him a little benefit of the doubt. Maybe he's saving up for a Super Bowl ad that maybe will reach 1% of the population. He just needs to bilk a lot of people for a lot of money in the meantime to get that money.
Is that really the right audience though, Russ?
I think he'll take it where he can get them. As long as an app is involved, put some filters on there.
The Scientologists have Super Bowl ads, so it's
well,
not that crazy.
That's
going
to appeal. Okay, but that's Scientology, Rob.
He's just saving his money and buying his time.
That's a different type of a cult, but I understand.
Yeah.
Well.
But these people.
I like this cult, though.
Yeah. They're a lot more stable-minded. They're clearly financially stable if they're going to be involved in this. But the thing is, it's the ultimate goal. Scientology is meant to crush people and oppress them. And this, I think it does have a little bit more of an optimistic edge. Maybe
it's peaceful. He's selling peace.
Maybe Dr. Greer's being like coached as far as like, maybe he's not all capitalist-minded, but someone's like, oh, you got to make money off of it somehow. And he's probably having somebody do this for him.
He's like,
just
the
being
app,
optimistic.
This app ain't going to design itself, man. We got to figure out a way to make some money off this. You know what I mean?
Yeah. He had a very pricey developer.
I still, the app is where it loses me too. I thought everything was about just like going in this and meditating.
What do you think goes on that app? Like just a big Zoom call of everybody around the world and then they all meditate at the same time?
I think it's like you get like a daily like wake up message like, do your best today to be.
We may need to. I may need to check it out. I may need to actually check this out.
Be your best self today.
Well, go check it out. Check in with us next time. We'll figure it out. We'll do it up. All right, but that's it. Let's get to our next segment. Let's get to the final week of the contest in the Unbelievers Voice Mailbag.
The Unbelievers Mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbox.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. The mailbag is cool. Mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time. Woo! Woo! Woo!
Yes, it's time for the final submissions of my soundboard voicemail competition where you're going to win an Unbelievers medal, and the second and third, maybe fourth, will all get something too. But this is the last week we're taking submissions, and we got quite a few, don't we, Rob?
We've got quite a few. I guess we should hop right into it.
We're going to get harder.
Let's do it.
Every week.
Hey guys, it's Corruption Mask, and you know, I've just been having not such a great week. I just worked for 6 days in a row. I had all sorts of drama there. And what makes it even worse is that I was offered a new job in the field that I studied all of last year for, but I had to turn it down because the pay was too low. So I've made a conscious decision to spend my two off days going on a bender. So right now, I just want to say, me like Long Island teas, so me drink Long Island teas. Long Island tea is good. Asta.
All right. Nice. Thank you, Corrupted Mass, for calling during a bender and giving us a new twist on an old classic.
Yeah. Me like corn. Be safe if you're having a bender out there. And some ice in your Long Island tea. You know what I mean?
But
it's better with some ice.
Yeah. If you are on a bender, definitely give us a call.
Yeah, for
appreciate
sure.
It.
And yeah, Rob likes it. Rob likes any Long Island talk out
yeah,
there.
Yeah, thank you for mentioning the beloved land that I come from.
There we go.
Which was invented in Tennessee.
My beloved home island.
Thank
of
you,
Long Island.
Bass. And thank you for still getting the ear of Violet Monroe. I think we got
Did
another
you say
one.
DeLong
don't we?
Island.
How dare you?
I thought you said that.
It's Unbeliever Brad. He blew my mind, blew up my head like a small alien on the roof or shit or something. And I'll tell you, I even told my mom about it, but she told me I was full of beans. But the truth is that I thought maybe you could interview me about golden rice. I'll
yes.
do a video if you want to. Look at that man.
All right.
I haven't heard that one in forever.
Oh, well, thank you.
I love the stringing together of them. That was really good.
Well, he had a whole bunch in there. What was a couple of them that he had?
Oh, man.
Golden rice. Look at that
the
mouth.
The first one, yeah, was, oh, my, I don't know how, it just flowed so naturally that I
interview
forget.
Me about golden rice.
Oh, I definitely
Full
know.
Of beans.
I know I heard this one. I definitely know I heard this one.
We saw some Martian or shit or something.
Definitely yes, heard that yes. one in there.
Quite a few good ones in there.
But then
there.
He capped it off with one of my favorites.
Look at that mouth.
I wasn't see. I didn't see that one coming
one is,
either.
That one is underappreciated for sure.
I love that. We've way to put it together. Thank you so much, Unbeliever Brad. And yeah, wait. Before we got into that, you said to DeLonge Island. So Rob's from Longe Island.
Yes, because DeLonge Island. Longe
Island. Longe Island. That's how Rob pronounces it.
Oh, fine.
Longe
Island.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. I think
I hate you guys.
I think we have another voicemail, don't we?
Hey, guys. What's up? Green Finhawk here with the Soundboard Challenge. So I was on the phone with my dad. I was telling him about some skunk burgers I ate last week. Then he said, "Do you eat roadkill?" I said, "Yeah." "Anyway, you do?" He said, "Yes, Dad. I ate roadkill. But right after my dinner, I felt sick. I remember grabbing my belt buckle with my left hand, I think it was. But I couldn't get my buckle undone in time. So I started throwing up and filling my pants. And I tell you, my butthole, that baby went into warp drive. And after that experience, I now know radioactivity settles in the anus. Because goddamn, smell it. But please don't tell anyone about my unusual diet, Dad. I'd kind of like to be a secret. Now I only eat ham sandwiches or tuna sandwiches. Discontinue.
That
wow. Way to close it out too. That was a long story.
A
on soundboard. That was really good. You'll have to give a couple for that, but man, that was pretty masterful.
Oh man, I will say one of them that stuck out to me that made me laugh for sure was when he mentioned that he was sick and he grabbed his.
I remember gripping my belt buckle with my left hand, I think it was.
Well, that's become an entire character in poll results, too, like the left-handed buckle grabber.
Yeah, and he had to grab his belt because, of course, he was.
Be throwing up and filling my pants.
Which I felt was very logical the reason to be grabbing your belt buckle with your left hand.
I'm so glad how this is ending. That this has kind of morphed from one person called with one, you know, just like it did last year, to the point of, you know, almost entire paragraphs all strung together with some disgusting tale.
And you know,
being spun.
He gets extra points because he threw this one in there.
You know, they like to be kind of like a secret.
Yeah, yes, Dad, don't tell him how he likes to eat roadkill.
Oh, shit. Oh, yeah, and that's one of my favorites.
It all started, yes.
It all started with that
burger.
One. That's what kicked it off. So, yeah, of course.
Do you eat roadkill?
Yeah, anyway.
You do?
Anyway.
Anyway.
Well, thank you Very so good. Much, Green Finhawk. I think we got a couple more, don't we?
Oh, yeah. We got some more stacked up here. Here we go.
Hello, guys. This is Darren Schisselbaum calling, and I would like to enter in the Soundboard Challenge. of 2021. Here it goes. Whoa, whoa, whoa. He just gotta take me on like that?
Thank you, Darren Schitzelbaum. We haven't heard from Darren Schitzelbaum in, man.
I guess it's, you guys haven't been to the library lately.
Not heard at all from him, but he got a good specific one there.
I guess I guess we're gonna play the clip. What was he wanted this one? It didn't really sound like it, but here we go. Here's the clip.
whoa! Hold on, he's just gonna take me on like that.
So hey, Darren Schitzelbaum. Darren Schitzelbaum was doing an impression of someone doing an impression of Jesse Ventura. So it's a little game of telephone where a few elements get lost in the original. But let's see what else we got.
All right, let's move along here.
Hey, guys, this is Darren Schitzelbaum calling down. I decided to do a...
Schitzelbaum?
Unbelievers. There we go. Okay. Don't be afraid. I'm your friendly weatherman.
All right, now, Darren Schitzelbaum, you have found your wheelhouse right there. Now, I thought that was the weatherman the first time we got it. That was pretty good. Let's play the original. That's a keeper.
All right. I guess we didn't specify how many times you could, like, you're allowed to enter.
Enter early, enter often. So,
there's no rules here. So
all the time.
Don't be afraid. I'm not going to hurt you. I'm the weatherman.
Okay, thank you, Darren Schitzelbaum. Now I'll just think of him now. That's knowing your character and knowing what clips you can do.
Knowing your strengths. Yes.
Let's hear what else we got.
Yes, hello. I am calling to find my long-lost brother. His name is Hose B, and my name is Hose A. And our father, well, he is a fireman. And I'm wondering if you could help me find my brother. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Hose B.
Well, I guess they called the right missing persons hotline.
What is going on?
I don't know what's happening now. I really don't. Thank you, Hose B and Jose and Jose, whoever else is
out
there.
I'm so confused. I don't know what just happened. We got more, though.
Let's go on. I think there's one more, right?
We got one more. Here we
go. All right, let's hear the final submission for this year's wonderful soundboard competition. It's gonna make you guys make it so hard. Let's hear the final one.
Here we go.
I'm sorry, Baskin Robbins, but there's more than 31 flavors here.
Right,
that's it.
Okay, a clown version.
Let's hear that one more time. I think there might be something after. Let me just play this again because I want to make sure we didn't miss anything on this clip.
Okay.
I'm sorry, Baskin Robbins, but there's more than 31 flavors here.
Is this supposed to be the one person laughing in the
crowd?
That's
the crowd laughing.
Well done. Very good. And yes, let's hear him.
And my apologies to Baskin Robbins. There's more than 31 flavors there.
Yeah, now that you hear the laughter afterwards, it's way better.
Very well done.
That makes
Very
it so
well
much
done.
Funnier.
All right. I'm closing it up. Let's get out of this. That was it for the Unbelievers voicemail bag.
The Unbelievers mailbag.
Ooh, right in the mailbag.
Hey, man, check your mailbag.
Hey, you got some new mail over here.
Mailbag. The mailbag is mailbag.
Sup, bitches. It's mail time. Woo! 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 Woo!
Okay, well, of course, we've come to the end of the program, but we've got one more thing to do. What's that, Drea?
Poll results.
This week's poll, what is going on in the 37th parallel? And the choices were alien underground bases, coincidence, government testing, both. I don't know, the both will be in there somewhere or other. I'm going to ask you, Drea Mora, what do you think the Unbelievers said?
Underground bases? It's everything. It's all the above, but...
Okay, yeah. You got alien underground bases. Alien what about bases, you, Rob? Yes.
I think they went with both because I think like we do kind of know that it is a little bit of both from like the Phil Schneider story and Bob Lazar. So, yeah.
Congratulations, Drea Mora, with 12.5% of the vote. Alien underground bases.
Ridiculous.
Nothing else. Yeah. Zero for both. Sorry.
It should have been both. Y'all are wrong, but yeah. Thank you.
No, Unbelievers think it's just alien bases. But I mean, to be honest, most of them think it is other. What is going on in the 37th parallel? The astrally projected out to me, entered my dream dreamscape, tried to sodomize me, long story, I fought it off, signed Rococo style. Okay. Thank you, Rococo style.
Astrally projected out to me, entered my dreamscape, tried to sodomize me, long story, I fought it off.
All right, that is the person who is...
of the Rococo style that embellished the building.
What is going on in the 37th parallel? The 37th is just the line Gray split hot dogs on. Signed, Hose B. Hose B from the voicemail earlier. I got one for... Give him something, Phil Schneider. He didn't get a lot of love.
Crispy crittered my left foot.
Crispy crittered his hot dog.
Thank you, Hose B. What is going on in the 37th parallel? They are playing paranormal connect the dots. We should play. Choose 2 points on a map, draw a line, and let your brain be a shooting star. Signed, Unbeliever Adam, who should be Unbeliever No Spaces Man now, because this is a rare No Spaces reply. We haven't had a No Spaces Man in a long time.
Well, good job reading it then.
And but he just wants us to let...
Your brain is a shooting star, son. Very funny.
Thank you, Unbeliever Adam. What is going on in the 37th parallel? Think to unthink everything you thought. UFOs are real. Tomatoes go in the fridge. Eat hamburgers destructively. Rub more heads. Sign Madman. Oh, yeah. Madman is losing it. I love it. Time to unthink everything you thought? No, I think our new one is.
It just doesn't make sense.
Rethink everything you think you know.
Yes, of course. He doesn't want to peacefully do this. He wants to destructively eat hamburgers and then rub heads.
Peacefully getting a hamburger.
And I think he threw a Dini Petty in there too. There's a lot going on.
Yeah, I gotta get the rub heads in there too.
It's so much.
Nah, you can forget about the head rubbing.
Come on,
just give us Dini.
Apples stored with green tomatoes will hasten the ripening process.
Okay, thank you, man. Very good. What is going on in the 37th parallel? I thought I knew, but then I rethought what I thought I knew, and now I'm like, why? What? Signed, left-handed buckle grabber. Her already got a little mention earlier. Nice. I like to rethink thing.
You know, UFO alien. Then the question is, well, why? I mean, what?
Yes. Thank you to the guy who is, God.
I remember gripping my belt buckle with my left hand, I think it was.
Thank you, left-handed buckle grabber. What is going on in the 37th parallel? Cool, the magic of green screen technology. Well, what happened? Hey, stay in the lines, Tommy. Stay in the lines. Signed, The Machinist. Oh, the stay in the lines. Very good. The magic of green screen technology. That's what's going on in the 37th parallel? Yeah, you remember that, stay in the lines?
Yeah, coloring Nazi.
That's right. But a good old...
What happened? I don't.
We don't know, Tommy. Thank you, Machinist. What is going on in the 37th parallel? It's a giant party. Hola, mija. Signed, Yankee boy cock lover. Thank you, Whoa. Yankee boy cock lover, for giving us a good old.
Hola, mija.
I kind of missed the Yankee boy. I haven't heard the Yankee boy in a little while. It's good to have him back.
Hey, Yankee boys, do you need some help? I'll give you a hand. I can fix your craft.
Thank you, Yankee Boy Cock Lover.
So genuine.
I can fix it.
Just the nicest. Canadians are the best. What is going on in the 37th parallel? I crossed the 69th parallel once. It was pretty painful. Signed, Harley Warren. Very good, Harley Warren.
I had an erection for like 6 hours afterwards, and it was pretty painful.
It was just like crossing the 69th parallel. What is going on in the, 37th parallel? It's a line across the country. Draw any other random line and find a bouquet of novel black flags and buckle grabbers. Signed, Joe Obvious. You're right, Joe Obvious.
Oh, how dare you, though?
Find a lot of stuff. You can find black flags and buckle grabbers. Buckle grabbers. Little
entertainers. Go on, go, explode out!
What is going on in the 37th parallel? I can't say what is going on in, but I can tell you what's going into the 37th parallel, Ooh. And it's quite very nice for her. Signed, AIP, or AEIP, APE? I don't know. Thank you, AIP. All right, it's not about what's going on, it's about what's going in. What is
very
going
nice
in
for
and going...
her. I feel like that, was that a clip? That wasn't a clip.
It sounds familiar, but I think it might have been Unbelievable. It
seemed to be quite very nice for her.
Quite very nice for her. Thank you so much. What is going on in the 37th parallel? Who knows? Who really cares? Just live your life and enjoy a fruit diet. Signed, Wholesome Steven. Oh, Wholesome Steven. Oh, is this Steven Greer?
Like, he knew like we were doing Steve this? Jobs thing.
Oh, wow. So many parallels. 37
Dang.
Of them.
All right, God. Wholesome Steven. What is going on in the 37th parallel? They are building a new hotel there as the aliens are fucking intense. Signed, and the aliens are fucking intense. Signed, Nuka-Cola, my blood is in it. Thank you, Nuka-Cola, my blood is in it. What is going on in the 37th parallel? It's aliens or shit or something. Signed, Mothman Mother. Very good.
We saw some Martian or shit or something.
You got it, Mothman Mother. What is going on in the 37th parallel? We already know who was touching all the babies, but now we know where. Signed, Triad Baby Emergency. Thank you. Triad Baby Emergency. Now we know where this is happening, where
and
people
what
are.
What I wound up doing is that I wound up touching all the babies.
Thank you, Baby Emergency. What is going on in the 37th parallel? Get your kicks and a blowjob on parallel 37 and go to heaven. Signed, Green Finhawk. Thank you, Green Finhawk. What is going on in the 37th parallel? Seems like a lot of Yankee boys that need help with their crafts. Sign the Wombat Preservationist.
It's not wrong.
Hey, Yankee boys, do you need some help? I'll give you a hand. I can fix your craft.
It's across the entire country. What is going on in the 37th parallel? Wait, damn it! That's where I left my jacket in 8th grade. Signed, Corrupted Mask.
That's pretty good.
Thank you, Corrupted Mask. I'm glad we could help with that. What is going on in the 37th parallel? Is there a future Mrs. Pantsfiller Sugar Mama to finance my UFO and Bigfoot exploits? Signed, Pants Filler. Yeah, everybody
They're
needs a
there.
Wife like Chuck Sikowski for sure. There's one out
Be
there for you.
Throwing up and filling my pants.
She'll put
and
up
she'll
with it.
Buy a newspaper for you. It'll be great. What is going on in the 37th parallel? I did not put element 115 in my anus, you bitch, Janice. I gently placed it between my butt cheeks. Big difference. Signed, BL. Thank you, BL. Oh,
I think
man.
That stands
Poor
for
Janice.
Blood Block, maybe.
Oh, should we hit him with this?
We know that radioactivity settles in the anus.
That works.
Unless you gently place it between your butt cheeks. Big difference. Thank you, BL. What is going on in the 37th parallel? I don't know, but I wouldn't go dogging there. Side, K-Mill, don't bring dogging. All right.
Dogging?
Thank you, K-Mill. What is going on in the 37th parallel? In the prequel, the 36th parallel, Chuck Sikowski eats roadkill from America's Paranormal Highway. Signed, that's a final one. Signed, Russ of Yorkshire. What? Always oh fun.
Do you eat roadkill?
Yeah, anyway.
You do?
You do?
Thanks, yeah. As always, everyone. Great replies. Let's go over them real quick. What's going on in the 37th parallel? We had Rococo style with the Astrally Projected Out to Me, Enter My Dream, Dreamscape, Try to Sodomize Me. Long story, I fought it off. We had Hose B with the 37th is just the line gray split. Hot dogs on. We had Unbeliever Adam with the hair playing paranormal, connect the dots, we should play. Choose 2 points on a map, draw a line, and let your brain be a shooting star. We had Madman with think to unthink everything you thought. UFOs are real. Tomatoes go in the fridge. Eat hamburger. Destructively rub more heads.
Who was that one? Left- Who was that?
That is Madman.
Madman.
We had left-handed buckle grabber with I thought I knew, but then I rethought what I thought I knew, and now I'm like, why? Wait, what? We had the machinist with cool the magic of green screen technology. What would happen? Hey, stay in the line, Tommy. Stay in the lines. We had Yankee boy cock lover with it's a giant party. Hola, mija. We had Harley Warren with I crossed the 69th parallel once. It was pretty painful. We had Joe Obvious. It's a line across across the country. Draw any other random line to find a bouquet of novel black flags and buckle grabbers. We had AIP with, I can't say what's going on in, but I can tell you what's going into the 37th parallel, and it's quite very nice for her. We had Wholesome Steven with, who knows, who really cares? Just live your life and enjoy a fruit diet. Nuka-Cola My Blood is in it with, they are building a new hotel there as the aliens are fucking intense. We had Mothman Mother with, it's aliens or shit or something. We had Triad Baby Emergency with, we already knew who was touching all the babies, but now we know where. We had Green Finhawk with, get your kicks and a blowjob on Parallel 37 and go to heaven. We had, now I see that it rhymes. I didn't really catch it the first time. Now we have the Wombat Preservationist with, seems like a lot of Yankee boys need help with their crafts. We had Corrupted Mask with, wait, damn it, that's where I left my jacket in eighth grade. We had Pants Filler with, is there a future Mrs. Pants Filler Sugar Mama to finance my UFO and Bigfoot exploits? We had BL with, I did not put element 115 in my anus, you bitch, Janice. I gently placed it there between my butt cheeks. K-Mill, what was that? We had Russ of Yorkshire with, in the prequel, the 36th parallel, Chuck Zukowski eats roadkill from America's paranormal highway. I'm going to ask you, Drea Mora, who do you think won this week's poll?
Oh, man, this had so many good ones. Like, but I think the one that kind of makes the most sense is Wombat Preservationist. Seems like a lot of Yankee boys with need help with their crafts.
All right, what about you, Rob? Who do you think won?
That one made me laugh a lot, too, but I got to go with Madman. I like Madman.
That was my second.
I thought it was very well put together, and it's like a bizarro universe version of our show. Yeah,
that was in the lead for sure for me for a long time.
Okay, well, congratulations with Think to Unthink Everything You Thought. UFOs are real. Tomatoes go in the fridge. Eat hamburgers destructively. Rub more than heads. Congratulations, Madman! You just won this week's poll results.
And yo, since he won and we didn't play the clip for him the first time, I'm going to play this now because I love this one. I'm sorry.
Yeah, next time you're with your girlfriend, start rubbing heads. Trust me on this.
Trust me on this.
Trust me on this. I'm sorry.
We'll never escape
but
his
rub
gaze,
more than heads.
Yeah. And yeah, we're about to do plugs, but I just wanted to give a shout out to Phil from TYO Toys. He sent me a custom-made Unbelievers podcast bowl, an actual really nice little ceramic bowl with our logo emblazoned inside the
as
bowl.
In, as incredible. In, of course.
We went to this room. There was this bowl on this table, and I was supposed to ejaculate into the bowl.
The very same, but don't give Russ that idea. Like,
I don't like that he said he's tested these bowls a bunch to make sure they're of the highest quality. That was quite upsetting, but I want to say thank you.
I think he gave you a pristine one. Yeah, it's very
good. I was going to ask what that meant, but I was like, maybe I'll just, I don't even want to get into it. Yeah.
I know exactly what it meant. And yes, thank you, Phil. Thank you, TYO Toys. And that's my plug. Before we go, Drea Moore, do you have anything you'd like to say or plug?
You can follow my other podcast, Spirits and Spirits Pod, at Spirits and Spirits Pod on Instagram.
All right. Awesome. How about you, Rob?
Check out our Instagram, Unbelievers Pod on Instagram. Check out my Instagram at Rob Okey. And you can check out at Okey Audio if you want to see some of the other stuff I'm working on. And we just posted on our Patreon the watch along for Fire in the Sky, which we watched
Fire
last
Sky
week.
Commentary.
That was fun.
Got to hear me play the clip of Travis Fulton saying, hey, hold a minute, hold it right there. I got to play that about 10,000 times. So if you want to hear that, you can check that out.
Check that out. Yes, we got more fun stuff coming to Patreon. We got a new episode coming there soon, too. And that's it. The Unbelievers Podcast host today were Drea Mora and me, Rus Ryan. Our producer and soundboard engineer is Rob Okey. You can get our tarot cards at unbelievablepodcards.com. You can join our Patreon by going to patreon.com/unbelieverspodcast. You can follow the show on Twitter and Unbelievers Pod and Instagram and Unbelievers Podcast. Our Facebook group is the Unbelievable Podcast Network. Check out our merch store at TeePublic. The link is in the descriptions. All kind of fun new stuff there. And thank you so much to all our patrons: Johnny Knott, Sandy and Deborah Foles, Cade Bote, Chris Stroker, Jeffrey Hartenraff, Luis Peon, 8-Bit Melody, Jenny Dyer, Christopher Balderama, David Egelhoff, Pam Z, JT Spranklin, Vic Voss, Little BB, Dr. Ortega, Tyler Ventura, Adam Dvorak, Corrupted Mass, Michael Phillips, Weary Axel, Carol Valley, Manny, MQ Ultra, CJP, Braden Hitt, Raymond Well, Todd X, Christopher Panici, The Moon, The Judgy Moon, Mike Henry, Bryce Kronenberg Jr., Don Bright, Shannon Ferrigno, Tom O'Connell, Mark Braun, Donna Banz, Jenna Stevens, Cat Chaos, Jason Kelly, Mike, Brian Ashton, Michael Armenta, Jackass, Wombat Preservationist. Our music advisor is Pandora 3373. Our official composer and theme song creator is Unbeliever A.A. Ron, a.k.a. Aaron Chilb. Follow him on Instagram at TheAaronChilb. Our official graphic designer and card maker, designer logo is Raymond Orwell. Check out his work at PRavenCreative on Twitter and Project Raven Creative on Instagram. Our official Unbeliever listening between the stations for a message from Art Bell, who has a birthday coming up, is Scott E. Our official Hazmat Lou is Hazmat Lou. Our official Unbeliever without a title is Nicholas Aristabi. Our official Unbeliever raising puck wudgies is Joe Filler. Our official Hawaiian paranormal investigator is Green Finhawk. Our official resident Sagittarius is Gozanton. Our official madman who won the poll tonight is Unbeliever Adam. Our official Mothman enthusiast is Michael Shields. Our official Unbeliever's MUFON inside man is Chris De Moraes. Our official Unbeliever's peacefully eating a hamburger is Michelle Dorham. Our official Unbeliever's time traveler is Taylor Nelson. Our official ghost hunter is Amelia Childs in Ghost in New England and Hubie Halloween on Netflix. Our official guardian of that bench is that Kraken Stacker. Where you at, buddy? I don't know where the bench is up to. Our official alien bopper is Nunchuck Bob. And this week's Unbeliever focus is Rick, who suggested we do a tournament of SOS, a T-O-S-O-S, a tournament of all the sacks of shit at once going at each other. I love the idea, and we might have to figure out how we would do that.
They're going to fight?
And I think so. We'll have to figure it out. A tournament of shitbags. It might happen. But when I asked if there were any other Unbelievers who would support this idea, he said,
"Look, there's four.
Good night. Bye, Lulu.
Discontinue! Discontinue!